Hi guys, welcome back to Kidz Church 2 Worship Service Online. I'm so glad you're here today. I hope you guys had a good week. I'm sure you're getting adjusted with school. Well, let's get started with prayer. If you need to use the bathroom or a water break, please pause the video. If not, let's start with prayer. Father God, we thank you for this Sunday. We thank you that even still we are not at church, you are still with us. I pray you bless every home as they're going back to school and studying, God, and building a new routine, Lord Jesus. We just ask, Lord God, that your spirit will be with them as they study, as they read your word, and as they worship you today. I pray that you be with us, and may you be worshiped, may you be glorified, may you be honored. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, amen. Well, let's get ready for worship. Let's stand up where you are and let's sing to the Lord.
High exalted, glorious in heaven. All right, it's time for offering. So let's take it out from a chair, backpack, Bible, from your parent maybe, wherever it may be. So remember, you got your offering, two hands in respect. You can say a small prayer before you pull it in. So let's start.
Dear Lord, who is faithful and forgives us, thank you for blessing us with a wonderful community during this quarantine, and thank you for keeping us safe. I pray that you will guide us through this new school year and that you will bless us. I pray for church leaders and school teachers that you will keep them safe. We pray for the sick that you will heal them and that COVID-19 will be controlled soon. I also pray for the Holy Spirit to come on us and our offering. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Elijah, for your offering prayer. I hope you guys keep sending your offering prayer. We are in need of them for this month of September. So if I ask you, please have courage and boldness and send us a video. Thank you. And let's get into our announcements. Today we will continue our Zoom online and it's going to be at 1:30. I hope you guys are there. I know, guys, that you're on computer each day, but it's really important that we connect, that we talk about God, that even when we share about how our week is, you know, that's different than going to school. So I hope you guys come at 1:30. If you haven't joined us yet, there's always anytime you can join us. And I hope you guys know that we have great teachers who love you, who are praying for you, and who want to connect with you. So meet us here at 1:30, especially for our fourth graders. We still want to get to know you. I'm sad that I can't see you in person yet, but I hope that Zoom is one way that I can get to know you. If you missed out for a couple of Sundays, don't worry about it. It's never too late. Please still join us and join us anytime. And we do play games and we just get to know each other and we just share how our week is and we share one question from the lesson. So it's really easy and it's simple, but it's important to connect and build relationship with another. So I hope you guys join us and hope to see you guys at 1:30. And let's continue studying the word. We have our Bible reading plan. So this is for this month. I hope you guys are able to do it each day. Just spend a few minutes in the word and in prayer. You guys, during this season, we are still in need of a lot of prayers. I'm sure some of you guys are just wanting to go back to school, wanting to go back to church. I am too. And the only thing we can hold on to right now is God's word. That is the only peace that gives us true peace, you know? Everything else is distractions. Everything else kind of just helps our time go by fast. But what's in our heart and what's in our mind, we need to be renewed daily, be transformed through His word. So I hope you guys, if you haven't been able to do it yet, it's there for you. I send it out in email or in Kakao. Please text me or email me at this email address if you still haven't received it. I would love to send it to you. And it's never too late to start, so don't feel like you're behind or anything, and you can start anytime. Right, okay, so now let's get into our story. So let's open up our Bible to Luke chapter 15. So if you have your Bible, let's have it ready. Today I'm going to read from NIV. And also let's have your sermon notes ready and have it right next to you. So I'm going to get my table ready and grab a pen. And sermon notes, as you're listening to the message, you can always pause it and write your notes. Don't feel like you have to be rushed. Sometimes I can talk really fast, so don't feel like you're behind or anything. This isn't school. We're here learning about God. So you take your time. And these questions, you know, do the best you can to answer them. I can't wait to read them. So store it in a binder or store it in a folder. So when we return, I actually read each one. So I'm looking forward to that, to study and to also learn what you say and what your thoughts are and the questions that you have about God. That's one of my favorite parts, and the prayer request that's written on there. So please have that right next to you and let's get ready. Before we get into the story, let's do a quick review of last week's message. So last week we talked about the parable of the hidden treasure. We also talked about the parable of the mustard seed and the yeast, right? That's in our bread that grows, helps us to grow. So in this story, we're reminded that the kingdom of God, that the God's word, that the gospel is something to be treasured. It's something to be valued. And I hope, guys, that during this season, more than anything else in this world, that the Bible and who Jesus is most valuable to you, something that you cherish. Just like this picture, that he treasures it like a treasure chest, right? That he found something so valuable that he values it and it's important to him, right? That he even hides it, that's hidden in his heart. So I hope that's the same for you guys. If not, that's something that you can pray for, to ask God, Jesus, will you be my treasure? Will you be the most important, most valuable God to me than anything else in this world? You guys, we have lots of gods. We might not have lots of statues where we worship gods, but there's lots of things in this world, like our toys or our friends or even our family, that they become God to us, where we worship them, where we think they're most important, where it kind of tells us who we are. So if our parents are not happy at us, we think we're like the worst kid. Or when we our friends don't like us, then we think we're never gonna have friends and we're always gonna be lonely. Or when we don't have enough toys, that means like we're missing out on the things of fun. So those things, when they become way too much more important than God, that is your God. But here Jesus is reminding us, am I your treasure? Is the gospel, what I did for you on the cross, is that the most valuable thing in your heart and in your life, right? That what Jesus says about you is way more important than your parents, than your friends, or than the things that you have, right? Is Jesus, what he says to you in the Bible, way more important than the things of this world? Well, I hope that that's your treasure. I hope that you value who Jesus is. That's my prayer for you guys. In Kidz too, we really learn about who Jesus is in our life, right? For the years, you guys have been learning about who God is, and now it's about to apply it. Now you guys are kids too, especially for our fourth graders. The challenge is applying it in your life, really saying, yes, Lord, you are more important than my friends. Yes, Lord, you are more important than my family. And yes, Lord, you are more important than the things of this world, than my toys, right? Or the things that I have, like video games. So these are the things that we get challenged at Kidz too. And I hope you guys study and know God, because in order for him to be valuable, you have to know him. You have to know and understand who God is. Then he becomes more and more important to you. Amen? Well, let's do a review of our Bible verse. This is a Bible verse that we like to refer to based on the couple of messages that we have. We're going through a series called Parables, and I'm going to talk a little more about that. But this is the Bible verse for this series. So it's a good reminder of why we're learning this, but it's also a way to memorize your Bible verse. I'm sure in Kidz 1 and in other ministries, you guys learn to memorize. So I encourage you guys to memorize, and it'll be great to hear you memorize it. So please do it, practice it at home, and it's a good thing to store in your heart. So let's read it together. He has rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of the Son. He loves. In him we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Colossians chapter 1, verse 13 to 14. So he rescued us from darkness, guys. That when we are trapped with sin, we are trapped in darkness. We can't see God. Right? Sin isn't just about doing bad things. It's actually darkness in our hearts, and we can't see him. So Jesus came to die for that punishment of our sin so that we can see God, so that we can believe in him. And he sent us through Jesus' death, through his death, to have a relationship with us, right? Through him, we are able to have a relationship with us, and we are redeemed, we're forgiven. And that's why this is called the kingdom of God. This is called the gospel. This is what we live for. This is what we cherish. And that's what the parable is about learning and understanding the gospel and the kingdom of God, who God is, what he teaches us, and to cherish it and to learn from it. So let's get started. Well, let's start off with the parables, right? What are parables? And we talked about it last week, right? We talked about how this is how Jesus told stories, stories about the gospel, stories about his kingdom and who God is, right? And he said it in a way where he didn't just explain to himself or explain to the people right away, but he used images, he used stories so that it can relate with those people, like a shepherd or a farmer or just a woman who lost a coin, you know? And he's trying to show how in these stories, what it means to value God. But you know, the tricky part about parables is that your heart actually has to be open and really trying to understand what Jesus is saying. It's not that easy to understand, you know, for the people maybe, but some people, they understood, they got it. What made it different from others to understand others? It didn't, right? And the Pharisees definitely didn't understand because it didn't relate with them, right? They weren't farmers, they weren't shepherds, they weren't just, you know, people that are just trying to find a coin. They were, you know, prestigious. They knew they knew everything. They were perfect. So for them, parables made no sense to them. And if anything, it came down to your heart. So I remember last week I talked about how Jesus was saying, you know, if you have ears, you know, have ears to hear, then, you know, then you'll understand these parables, right? If your heart is like a rock, right, then you won't be able to understand these parables. But that the opposite of something like a rock, which is hard, that a sponge when it's soft, that you can hear God's message and it can give you joy, right? So parables is about the heart. Where is your heart today? Is it like a rock where you're like, oh no, here's another message. Of course, you know, my heart needs to be like a sponge. But are you just saying that because you grew up having to be taught this way, or is it really true for you? So the challenge for you guys isn't that you don't know enough. You actually know a lot. You know a lot. You know God's word. You've studied it since you were a baby. You've heard these stories. The challenge is, where's your heart? Where's your heart? Is it like a rock? Has it grown hardened over the years? Or is this still like a sponge where God's word still speaks to you and helps you each day and makes you want to love God more? You know, sometimes when because I grew up listening to God's word and going to church, you know, there are times my heart was like a rock. It was, oh yeah, I already know this story, you know? But then I had to be reminded of these kind of stories where it's like, where's your heart, Sumi? Where's your heart to hearing God's word? And he would remind me is to stay like a sponge. And that's when I would ask Jesus, Jesus, will you forgive me? And will you help me to be a heart that's like a sponge, soaking God's word? You know, sponges, they soak water so easily. And that's the same heart that we need to have when we hear God's word, that our hearts will soak so easily through his word, right? When we hear it. And our hearts won't be hardened like a rock. But you know what happens over the years? If we don't check our heart, if we don't say, to be honest, yeah, my heart's like a rock. We have to be honest about it. Or it just happens. It just happens without us realizing. And over time, we don't want to listen to messages anymore. Over time, we stop reading the Bible. Over time, we stop praying. And we're like, what happened to me? Oh, I must not believe anymore. But it actually might be, oh, my heart got hardened. My heart became like a rock. Because I stopped asking God to make it soft like a sponge. So that's my prayer for you, that as you guys learn about these parables, that you would understand that it's not so much about knowledge, but it's also, knowledge is very important, guys. We need knowledge, right? The word of God transforms our mind, but it's also the heart and how we receive that. So we're going to go to this story, and there's three parables that we're going to go over, and it's reminding us to value the gospel, value God's word and his truth. So let's open up to Luke chapter 15, verse 1 to 7. So let's read that, 1 to 7. Now, this is called the parable of the lost sheep. So if you see here in this picture, this sheep looks really sad and it looks lost. And here we're going to understand Jesus' heart. His heart for you and me, his heart for sinners. And these parables are actually beautiful parables of God's love for you and me. So let's read that. Now the tax collectors and the sinners were all gathered around to hear him. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Verse 3, then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you had 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And verse 5, and when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulder and goes home and says, "Rejoice with me, I found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. This is a very important parable. Here, the tax collectors, you know, and they're sinners, you know, people judge them. They said they're bad people, you know, they're sinners. And especially the Pharisees. The Pharisees looked down on them, and Jesus ate with them. Jesus ate with the people that were not perfect. Jesus ate with you and me, because you know, you and I, we're not perfect. I am not perfect. If anything, as I got older, I've become less perfect, guys. And I need Jesus more as I've gotten older. And here Jesus is saying that I am here for the sinners. I am not here for the perfect people. This is why I love the gospel. This is why I love Jesus. This is why this faith is more real and true than any other religion. This is the true religion, the true way, the true belief, because there's no other religion, and I've studied other religion, that talks about the heart and the love of God. No other religion does that. We all are lost. We all are sinners. We're all imperfect. And here this God, right? Our God is saying, I want to save you. I want to rescue you. You are important. If you study other religion, it says you are God. You're perfect and you need to be perfect. That's what most other religions saying. But in Christianity, in our faith, in the truth of who Jesus is, he's saying, I know you're not perfect, but I still love you and I will help you when you are struggling. And here's a sheep out of the 100 sheep, and that sheep got lost. The sheep lost its way. The sheep maybe became curious, maybe got in trouble, right? And Jesus leaves the 99 saying, you guys are okay, but I'm going to keep you safe in this gate, but I'm going to go and save that one lost sheep. And look at that sheep. Sometimes we're lost. Sometimes we know that we get in trouble by our parents, or we know we did something wrong and we get lost. And Jesus, instead of saying, how dare you? How come you didn't listen to me? Jesus is the opposite. He says, come to me, or I will go to you, and I will rescue you, and I will save you. Now, how does he do that for you and me? He does that when he speaks to us when we read the Bible, when he encourages our hearts, or when we watch our sermons, he reminds us that he loves us. That God speaks in many ways, through our pastors, through our teachers, through the Bible, through a friend, through your parents, you know, the ones that encourage you and that remind you that Jesus loves you, right? Those are the voices that God may use to bring you back to him, right? Not the voice that tells you you're bad or you're horrible. You know, those are not the voices. Those are the enemy's voices. The enemy lies to you because it says, oh, look how bad Christian you are. Oh, you're not good enough. Oh man, Jesus doesn't like you. Those are the things that are not from God. You know, if that was, then Jesus wouldn't go after that sheep. Jesus would punish that sheep, saying, how come you left? How come you didn't stay with the rest of the crowd, you know? But instead, Jesus says, I'm here to save you. Now let's go to another story, right? So let's hear the parable of the lost coin, verses 8 to 10. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Does she not light a lamp? Here is this picture of her lighting a lamp. Sweep the house and search carefully until she finds it. And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me. I have found my lost sheep. In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of God over one sinner who repents. Now, repentance doesn't say, Jesus, I'm so bad, I'm so horrible, and forgive me. Okay, that's part of our repentance. But repentance means when we turn to God. When we turn to God, that we don't look at our sin or our ways of doing things, but we turn to God and says, I want to follow you instead. Yes, Jesus, clean my heart. Yes, Jesus, help me to forgive others who have hurt me. Right? Because if we don't repent, we're like, we get mad when people hurt us, or we stay in saying it's not fair, or we do things our way and we become stubborn, or we're just hurt and sad and lonely and we're like, no one cares for us. And that's our way of doing things. But repentance is turning away from the way we do things and we turn to God and say, Jesus, clean my heart, for it's been hurt by others, right? Maybe that's one way of you guys coming to God in repentance. Help me to forgive others, or help me to follow you because I want to do things my way, right? So that's true repentance. It's turning away from your old ways and turning to God. And here, Jesus is reminding you that you are that lost coin, right? You are that lost sheep. You're important. You know, this picture of this woman, she had 10 coins, but she searched. She turned on the light. She cleaned the house and she searched for that one lost coin. If I had 10, I'd be like, you know what? I'm sure I'll find it. I'm sure it's around the house and it's not that important. But for this woman, no. She said, it's important. I got to turn on the lights. I got to look for it. It's very precious to me. Same thing as the shepherd, right? Oh, I have 99 sheep. You know, one gets lost. It gets eaten by the wolf. That's fine. I have 99. He could have done that. But no, he said, no. That one sheep that's lost is special to me. That sheep is important to me. And that's the heart that he has for you and me. You are important to Jesus. I am important to Jesus. He said, you are worth dying for, and you are also worth rescuing. And when you're lost, and when you get mad, and you're stuck in your ways, right? All you need to do is say, help me. Because, you know, when we're lost, it's good to ask for help. And we say, help me. Help me, Lord. Jesus will bring you back to him. That's the beauty of these parables, is you're seeing Jesus' heart, that he loved sinners, that he loved the imperfect people, but he wanted them to come to him. He didn't just love them, he wanted them to come to him, and he went out to rescue them. So he goes out to rescue you. He's always knocking on your door. The question is, do you see him? Do you see that he's doing that in your heart? I hope today that you realize he is. He loves you so much. You are so important to Him. Sometimes we don't feel like our family or our friends or even the world thinks we're important, but Jesus does. He actually says He knows your name. He made you. He knows all the numbers of hair in your head. It says in the Bible. And you know, it took me a long time to realize that He really did. I just believed in Jesus because of who He was. But then there was a time where I realized He really knew me. He really knew my name and He knew my life and He was really there as I depended on Him more. And when I felt lost, I kept turning to Him and He showed me, Sumi, I know you. This is why I believe in Jesus. This is why the gospel is important to me. And I hope you experience that during this week as you go through your struggles, that you invite Jesus into your heart, that if you're lost, just say, help me, Lord, and He will bring you back to Him. Amen. And the one last story, it's a story that we heard at VBS, and I'm going to go quickly over it, but it's from verses 11 to 31. And this is another part of who Jesus is. This is God's heart for us as a Father, a wonderful Father for us, a heavenly Father, different than our earthly fathers. You know, our earthly fathers are not perfect, but our heavenly Father is. So let's read this story. It's the parable of the lost son. And you, as we're reading it, you're going to be like, oh yeah, this is the VBS story. So Jesus continued, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me the share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together and all he had set off for a distant country. And there squandered his wealth in wild living. And after he spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to him his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with pods at the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. So a pause here. As you guys know, the younger son said, I want my money. And he wanted to get out of his house and he just wanted to have fun. And he ended up spending all his money. And then he realized he had to eat. And then he couldn't find any job except to feed the pigs. And the food of the pigs looked yummy to him that he wanted to even eat that, you know? And verse 17, when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will send out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son and he threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to the servants, quick, bring the best robe, put it on him. Put on a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For the son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and found. So they began to celebrate. And meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard the music and the dancing. He called out one of his servants and asked him, what's going on? Verse 27, your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him safe and sound. And 28, the older son became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered to his father, look, all these years, I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when the son of yours who has squandered with your property with prostitutes comes home, you killed the fattened calf for him. Verse 31, my son, the father said, you're always with me and everything I have is yours. But we have to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and it is found. Now, in this story, the younger son realizes, oh, I can go back to my father and ask for a job, you know, forget being a son. I'm sure he's mad at me. I wasted all his money. I was spoiled. I was a brat. I did whatever I wanted. Of course, he's not going to take me back as a son, right? So he's saying, you know, I'm just going to say I'm sorry, and can I just work for you? So he goes back, but instead of like getting punished, you know, the father celebrates. He celebrates over his young son coming back. You guys, that's the Father's heart for you and me. That's our Heavenly Father. That's our God. He celebrates when you go back to Him. He celebrates when we worship Him and when we turn away from our old ways and we follow Him. He celebrates over you. That is the heart of God. That is the Father's heart. And you know, the older son, who's such an obedient son, you know, listened to his father and never left his father. He was jealous and he was mad, like, hey, why does he deserve a party and I don't get a party? I should get a party. You know, I kind of understand the younger son. I might not have been as rebellious or as wild as that younger son, but I as a kid would be as obedient as I could. And sometimes I felt like, God, you know, I deserve better in my life because I obeyed you. I do this, 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 and this. And you know, I didn't understand God's heart. I didn't understand the gospel, that no one deserves anything, that we all are celebrated, that the Father was saying, you know, everything is yours, my son. Let's just celebrate because your younger brother was lost. Have that heart that he was lost, but he came back to me. He came back to our family. And we gotta celebrate that. And the older son didn't understand, saying, and the father loved that older son. He didn't punish the older son. He could have punished the younger son. He could have punished the older son. He could have said to the younger son, you're right. You don't deserve to be my son. He could have said to the older son, how dare you? You know, I even gave you the food. You know, you should be thankful. No, he didn't do that to the older. He said, you know what? Everything is yours. This all belongs to you. You know, if you're that obedient child of God that obeys Jesus, that obeys the best you can, Jesus honors it and says, everything is yours. I see your obedience. And I want to encourage you today that maybe you're not the lost one, but you're the obedient one. Still, Jesus says you're important. You're precious to him. And that's what the father was saying to the older son. So today's message, it's really the story about God's love for you and me, that Jesus really seeks the sinners, right? And that we're all sinners. That older son was a sinner, the younger son was a sinner. No one was perfect. As much as we obey, try to obey, we can't measure up. I can't measure up. And that's what I love about Jesus and the gospel. Because Jesus is saying, it's not about your obedience. It's about me and what I did on the cross for you. So receive that in your life, right? So receive that. He saved us from our sin and he keeps blessing us still. And that's the heart of the gospel. And I hope you guys treasure that, just like that other parable. Treasure in your heart and understand it and love Jesus more. Amen? Amen. Well, let's watch this quick clip about this story and then let's close in the time of prayer.
Tax collectors and sinners came to listen to Jesus teach. The religious leaders complained because Jesus welcomed sinners. So Jesus told them three parables to teach them about God. Jesus said, "If a man has 100 sheep and loses one, what does he do? He leaves the 99 sheep and searches for the lost sheep until he finds it. Then he tells his friends and neighbors, 'Let's celebrate, I found my lost sheep.' In heaven, there is more joy when one sinner repents and turns back to God than for 99 people who did not wander off." Jesus also said, "If a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one of them, what does she do? She lights a lamp, sweeps the house, and searches carefully until she finds it. Then she tells her friends and neighbors, 'Let's celebrate, I found my lost coin.'" Then Jesus repeated, "In heaven, there is joy when one sinner repents and turns back to God." Jesus told a third story. A man had two sons. The younger son said, "Father, give me my inheritance today." So the father gave his son his share. The younger son left home. He wasted his money and lived foolishly. There was a famine and the people in that country did not have enough food. The son got a job feeding pigs. He was so hungry, even the pigs' food looked tasty. The younger son made a plan. He would go back to his father and admit he was wrong. He would ask to work for his father like the servants. So the younger son headed home. He was still a long way away when his father saw him coming. His father ran to him, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son began to apologize. "I have sinned against God and against you," he said. But the father told his servants, "Let's celebrate with a feast. Bring the best robe and put it on my son. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. This son of mine was lost, and now he is found." At this time, the older son came from the fields and heard music at the house. "What's going on?" he asked one of the servants. "Your brother is here," the servant said. "Your father is celebrating." The older brother was angry. He refused to go to the feast. The father asked him to come inside. The older brother said, "I never disobeyed you, but you never threw a party for me." "Son," the father said, "everything I have is yours. We have to celebrate. Your brother was lost, but now he is found." Jesus told stories about people who were looking for things that were lost. Jesus told these stories to teach about himself. Jesus looks for people who are lost, people who do not know him. Jesus gave his life to save people from sin.
Well, I hope you guys enjoyed this story, and let's pray, and let's just pray that our hearts will be just thankful for who Jesus is and what he has done for us. That he sees us as that lost sheep, the lost coin, the younger son, the older son, and we're all important to him. And that he doesn't punish us or says what wrong thing you've done. If anything, he loves us. It says in the Bible, it's his kindness that leads us to repentance. It's God's kindness that leads us to going back to God. That's repentance. It's going back to God. And I hope you today go back to him and thank him for his love for you, that you are way more important. And I pray and hope that he is more important to you than your family, than your friends or your video games, that he is the most important treasure in your life. So let's pray. Dear Jesus, I thank you for this message of your love for you and me. Thank you that you gave your life for us, and that it is the greatest treasure that we can have. Thank you that you rescue us and you save us when we're lost like that sheep or like that coin. You don't forget about us. You run after us. You look for us. You seek us and you remind us who you are, God. Help us, Lord, to know that we are blessed and loved by you, God. I pray that today's message, that you would help your sons and your daughters to know how much they're loved by you, that you will go after them when they're lost, God. And I pray that when they are lost or when they feel like they've been obedient, but yet they're not happy, I pray you touch their hearts today. Fill them with the Holy Spirit. Help them to turn to you, God, and know that you love them still, and that we will come to you in repentance, knowing that we need you and that we want to follow you. We thank you, Lord, and we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, I hope to see you guys today at 1:30, and have a great week. And I'll be praying for you guys during this week with knowing that God loves you so much. Bye.